Hi guys, I'm Alex Fry. I was one of the comp leads on The Great Gatsby at Animal Logic. As you saw from that reel, most of the work on the film was set extension and full CG environments. It was Animal's fourth film with Baz Luhrmann. We did 590 shots, roughly, which accounted for just under an hour of the film. We had 175 crew, 44 of which were pure compositors, and then on top of that we had around 30 lighters who were spending about half their day in Nuuk, and about another 30 matte painters. We were spending most of their day in Nuuk as well. The show ran for about 18 months and was shot in full stereo using Red Epic cameras on 3-ality stereo rigs. We're just going to take a quick look at our plate ingest process here to start with. When anything came into the building, we would run a Python script that would generate a Nuuk script that would bring in the Mystica plates that had been delivered by the client, the original R3D RAW files that had been delivered by the client. It would look at the camera sheets and the EDLs, and it would construct this Nuuk script that you see here. What we're doing here is we're copying metadata that had been lost through the Mystica and copying it over from the R3D files. We're also taking metadata from the stereo rig and embedding that into the EXR data stream. And then we're rendering out new EXRs, so new Mystica frames which have additional metadata striped in, and new debayed EXRs from the R3D files. for any shot that was going to require a camera track, which for us was most of them, we ended up using the original R3D files rather than the Mystica plates. Basically, that came down to anytime you want to track something, if it's had geometric distortions applied to vertically aligned stuff, it makes it incredibly hard to track. So we would go back to the original R3D files and then generate a new ocular color match. So you can see here we have our original debayed plate coming in. As you see me toggling backwards and forwards here, the footage coming straight out of the camera was very good on Gatsby. They used a quarter wave retarder filter, which massively cut down any polarization asymmetry. And they had a couple of very talented guys on set who were doing a lot of work writing the metadata controls for the right eye to grade it to match the left eye. And also they just made sure they aligned the rig between every take. So the footage coming straight off set is very good, but we're still doing an ocular disparity generator, an ocular occlusion detector, and then we're running it into an ocular color match in local matching mode. We're also doing a vertical align off the left here. This is a camera style corner pin. But at this point in the pipeline, we don't want to commit to any vertical align solution. We want something that we can turn on, turn off, invert at any point we want. So rather than baking in that vertical alignment distortion in the right eye, what we're doing is packing the corner pin values into the EXR metadata. That then gets written into the EXR files and passed on down the pipeline. We're also pre-calculating our disparity pass and writing that out into a separate EXR that you can see coming off on the right here. The idea there is that we can use tools that require disparity down the pipeline much more cheaply because we've already done the expensive heavy lifting part. And we can also use the same disparity between departments. So matte painting and comp can be using the same disparity and get the same results. The bulk of the plates that we had worked perfectly with the local color matching, but some problem shots like you see here where we have repeating patterns or big asymmetrical camera flares, champagne spraying around, pillows exploding. We would sometimes need to go to a global color match and key mix it in certain areas, or when it got really severe, use ocular new view to generate a new right eye and mix that into sections where the original plate just wasn't recoverable. We were also bringing in grade data from set where the DOP had worked with the red grading tools to do a bit of look work on set, and we had to pick that up and carry it forward. Nuke will bring in R3D files, but it will only respect grades that maintain the image linearity. We needed a way of separating out any of the nonlinear grades and baking it into a single-space lookup file. So what we have here is a tool that can load the XML grade data, interpret that. It can look at a spreadsheet we're getting from production to marry up R3D files with RMD files. And we have a custom spline interpreter to match Red CineX's behavior. And then we're writing out that grading information as a CineSpace file with a 1D pre-LUT and a 3D LUT. So we can go float in, float out, either in Nuke or in RV, and apply those on-set grades just in time. We also implemented a shared toolsets feature for Gatsby. The idea here was to reduce the barrier to entry for people writing tools. We've got 44 compers and another 30 map painters and another 30 lighters, all who have specific little pipeline needs that they want to build tools for. But if you have to go through a formal release process and add something to the menu and it takes weeks and then it's a managed tool, it means that a lot of people just don't release a tool that they could. By hijacking Nuke's existing toolsets menu and turning it into a company-wide toolset menu rather than a local one, we're able to encourage that sort of behavior. So you can see here we've got every show within the building in its own sub-menu, then every user in each show, and then every tool that they've built there. So someone can just cook up a toolset, save it out, and yell to the guy two cubicles down and say, "Hey, I've got this tool, try it out, it's called this." And it worked very well. One of those tools was the Stereo 3D Visualizer. This is basically a wrapper around some of the ocular tools to allow us to visualize the stereo in world space. So you can see we've got an image feed here coming in, and then a tracked camera coming in on the top left. We're then using O-Solver and O-Disparity Generator to pass off to a disparity to depth node. Now that from the stereo disparity and the camera will let us generate a 0 to 1 normalized depth pass. Now, sometimes this would be enough to work out where something needs to be in space, but you would have to take a 3D object, render it out in the scaleline render node, look at the depth pass, and then measure the values relative to this to see whether you're in the right position. You could do that, but it's not very intuitive. So what we wanted to do was transform this Z data into PBW. So what we do here is we have an expression node, so 1 over the depth pass. It's going to go from normalized depth to scene scale depth. So you can see now 0 is the camera, and the values increase linearly out into the scene. So if you scrub over a pixel and it's got a value of 20, that's 20 world units away from the camera. We're then clamping some of that off using disparity to depth means you get a little bit of noise on distant objects. So we're just culling everything at the 3 meter mark in this case. We're then adding an XY gradient, and we're passing that into a position of points node. So that takes the XYZ coordinates we've just made and puts it into our 3D space. We're then using a trilinear node to splay that data out so it sits within the camera frustum. And then we're using a transform geo node to shift those points to the origin of the camera. We could do those with a color matrix node and add to the color data. But in this example, we used geometry modifiers. So you can see now, we can see our stereo plate in scene space. So we're visualizing disparity as 3D information. So now if I wanted to add, say, some cigar smoke behind Jordan's head, but in front of that other dude behind her, I can just stick that on a card, I can position that card in the scene, and that will be correct in stereo. We're not using recorded values on set, we're using the tracked camera that we're going to render the smoke through, and we're using the disparity. So, according to Oculus machine vision system, this is where this object will appear to be. You can also use it to check your assumptions with scene scale. If you've got a camera track that is perhaps 10 times too big or 10 times too small, this will very quickly show it up. You can throw in a 6-foot stand-in mannequin model and position it next to the people that you see in this scene here and confirm that things are really the scale that you think they are. It also very quickly shows up any problems with the track. If the interocular is wrong or the focal length is wrong, you'll see people distort and stretch in space. So you can see here that people are more or less in proportion. People further back in the scene are the same size as the people in the foreground. People's heads are more or less round. We're still seeing some noise here from the disparity pass, but we can get a pretty clear idea of what's going on. The next thing we're going to look at is the glam party sequence. We have a shot here. This is a party early on in the film at Gatsby's mansion. It's all been shot on soundstage in Sydney, and we've got a big blue screen up the back, and we're extending the set, and we're also adding a whole bunch of extra glitter to the foreground. So this is the original plate. A plate like this really makes it obvious why it's so much better to shoot stuff in stereo for real. All of this glitter, the sequins on the girls' dresses, you get a lot of natural asymmetry, which gives you the sort of sparkle that you only get with real stereo footage. You'll never get it with post-conversion footage. The same thing with the water in the pool. So we want to use Ocular here to suppress any problematic color differences, but we don't want to use it so severely that we destroy that nice stereo information. So we have our CG backplate here. The outside of the building, the trees on the left, and the ivy on the walls are all coming from the lighting department. They're rendering that in RenderMan. But the interiors of the mansion are all generated by the Mac painting department. So they're working in Nuke in the same world space as the lighting guys. They're using the same stereo cameras, and they're going in there with basic geometry, and they're texture mapping in all of the room interiors. So we've got matte painting working in Nuke, we've got lighting pre-copying their stuff in Nuke. That then gets handed off to Comp, and it gets dropped in the back of the shot here. We've also got a layer of CG glitter that we're adding in the foreground. There was glitter on set, but they wanted more glitter. If this was a 2D film, we could probably just lay that over the top and get away with it. There'd be some parallax problems, but yeah, with little bits of glitter that are flashing on and off, you'd probably be okay. But in stereo, that's not going to cut it, because we have different cues telling us what's in front of behind. So if we have a piece of glitter that's in front of you in 2D, but behind you in 3D, it looks weird and wrong. You have glitter inside people, and it messes the whole effect up. So what we do here is we take oculars disparity to depth node again. We then use that depth pass and make a pseudo deep image. And then we take the glitter pass and with its CG rendered depth pass also flip it to deep. Then we use Nuke's deep toolset to hold the glitter out, hold the backplate out from the glitter. So now we have something which you're effectively getting automatic holdouts. We're not having to roto all of those guys in the band, we're not having to roto the piano. It's all behaving correctly in stereo. Does it work 100% of the time? No, but it means the first time the shot goes up in the dailies, 90% of the glitter is in the right stereo space, and you just have to call out specific pieces here and there and have them painted out. So it's a good head start. Another sequence we're going to look at is the Times Square sequence. This, again, was all shot on a soundstage in Sydney. So it's a big CG environment job. And what we're going to look at specifically here is the animation of the signs. When we received the renders from lighting, we have something that looks like this. We've got lots of nice, busy detail down on street level, CG extras moving, cars driving around, but everything in front of the buildings, all of the signage, is all static. We could have animated this in surfacing or in lighting, but it would have meant a very long and tedious turnaround time to make changes to the animation. So rather than doing it that way, we wanted to animate everything in Nuke. So lighting would give us a pass that looks like this, and then a matching unlit pass where all of the lights are turned off. And then surfacing would tag all of the light globes with either red, green, blue, or CMY, and we could use those colors to isolate the globes, isolate the different globe types out and switch between the lit and unlit states of the image. So if we just did that without any way of controlling it, we'd get something that looks like this, which is, whilst interesting, not very useful for the shot. So we developed a little tool for animating those globes called the Neon Bulb Looper. It's basically like a MIDI or a mod sequencer from the 90s, and you can set a whole bunch of on-off states for the different light types. You can then define how many frames in that animation sequence we want to use, how fast it runs through them, how they blend together. And then we put together a comp that looks like this. So we have our lighting classes coming up the top left, so on state, off state, and PBW. We're then breaking up the scene using PMATs. So we're pulling mats on XYZ position data. And then for each sign, we have a separate bulb looper node where we set up a different sort of animation, different styles. We might be tracing around or turning signs on and off, different speeds. You know, sometimes they may even just be offset from each other, just so we have a bit of variety in there. We then recombine all of those, and we end up with something that looks like this. So we're just switching between the on and the off state of those renders. And we're selecting different signs using PMATs. The nice thing about that is we can now move the camera around, and we don't have to roto anything in or animate anything. It's all tracking with the background, and we can take that same comp setup and apply it to a different shot, like this one. So it made it very easy to develop the animation and then roll it out over the whole sequence. We used Ocular here as well. There's a lot of signs up the back of the street where even using 5K over-res PBW passes, we were running into asymmetry issues where things were sampling just slightly different left eye to right eye. So we would work up the animation with the left eye and then use Z to disparity and generate a new right eye using the Ocular New View tool. And then once we had that, we stack in everything else, matte painting up the back, atmospheric glaze, crowd, cars, live action in the foreground. Bit of flare over the top, and we end up with something that looks like this. Okay, another shot we're going to look at is the big bridge pullout shot. So this is Nick and Gatsby driving across the Queensborough Bridge into Manhattan. They're shot in a real Duesenberg on a soundstage, and then we hand off to a CG version of Nick and Gatsby, and then they drive off into this CG environment. So we have a mix of lighting and matte painting here. The bridge, the buildings on the near side, the boats in the water itself are all coming from lighting. And then the distant buildings, the sky, a lot of the vegetation on the bridge, that's all coming from matte painting, and they're working in Nuke. So lots of projections onto geometry. And then all of the atmospherics and all the integrations happening in the comp department. So this is the original plate. You can see very quickly we have a bit of a problem here in that the car is almost completely defined by its reflections. But those reflections are not of the right thing. It's not really going to be an option to paint those reflections out, especially in stereo. And even if we did, there would be nothing left. So it was easier for us to make the call pretty early on to just completely replace the car with a CG car. That way we could reflect the bridge and everything that was meant to be in the scene, not the soundstage. We're also using the ocular interaxial shifter to ride the interaxial of their stereo element through the transition. Basically, if you shrink down a stereo plate and make no other changes, the stereo appears to stretch out in the Z-axis. So we needed to compress that interocular during the transition period. You can also see here which parts of the scene are lighting and which parts are matte painting. Basically, if you can see the building in this render, it's probably from lighting. If you can't, it was done in matte painting. The nice thing about having all three departments working on the same platform is that we could all work in parallel. Matte painting could work up their parts of the shot, lighting could work up their renders, comp department could be dressing in atmospherics, and then we can bring all of that into one big monstrous script and render the whole thing at once. It would have been a lot more difficult if people were, you know, working in Photoshop and just handing us a card or just handing us a pile of renders. This way everyone's on the same page, everyone's looking at the shot the same way. We're not duplicating effort. So this is what the final shot looks like. During the trailer we had some interesting problems getting crowd cars to render. In Manhattan across the bridge there's a whole bunch of little cars driving around and you really need them to bring the city to life, but we just couldn't render them properly. And so we had to come up with a way of rendering crowd car elements in Nuke in a time frame that was going to make the deadline. So we took a turntable render of the car, the cars like this, and a corresponding PBW, or world position, pass of the same render. And then we would take multiple viewpoints and project those into 3D space using the position of points node. And then once we had those all together and had all sides of the car covered, we would emit a single frame particle system, which meant we could render those points in PR Man for Nuke. We would then attach those little point clouds to locators that were supplied by the crowd animation department. And we would get something like this. Obviously this isn't the animation. But you can see here that from image data, we now have little point clouds that act like geometry. So we can look at them from new arbitrary camera positions. They work in stereo, they motion blur, they occlude each other, but they render fast. This is a 30-second frame render, which for a couple of hundred cars at 2K is pretty respectable. The rest of the DR sequence had similar problems. We have stuff shot on location, sometimes in sunlight, sometimes in shadow, often not the right one for the shot, and then a mix of other shots that were shot on a soundstage. So we also had a cut that was changing as time went on. Sometimes a shot was in sunlight, sometimes it was going to be in shadow. So we needed to come up with a way of quickly adjusting and trying out great ideas over the sequence without regenerating new versions of all these shots with a potential grade in them. So what we did was use RV and its real-time grading tools to help us with that. So we have an RV session here. The sequence has been generated by a Python script which looks at our shot structure, looks at the ADL, and loads up all of the relevant shots. We can then use RV's grading tools, which can be done with real-time playback. And then we add an extra menu to RV, which allows us to export the whole sequence as a JSON bundle. We then have a corresponding node back in Nuke, which allows us to take that JSON data and construct a Nuke script, which has all of the information that we had in our RV session. So you can see here, all of the shots I had in my RV sequence are now ordered left to right. The editorial ins and outs are being reflected by the frame range nodes. We then have an RV file LUT node, which is matching RV's working space. Sometimes we might have a mix of Red Gamma 2 JPEGs and floating point EXRs, and we need to make sure we're matching all of the same transforms that RV's performing. And then we have this RV look LUT 3D CSP node. Basically what this does is take the grade choices that we made in RV, any arbitrary grades we made in Nuke, and it will generate a CineSpace lookup, which has a 1D shaper and a 3D lookup, much like the one we saw earlier on. So we can have floating point in, floating point out, but manipulate it with the 3D lookup table. And it will then write that out to the file system in a way that we can automatically pick it up in other places. So once we've come up with a grade that we're happy to try out and have a look, we can either load up an RV session and load those per shot grades, or we can load it up as a viewer input process in Nuke. Basically, it means we can try things out and not have to commit to anything, which was quite handy. And I think that's it. Thank you.